Yes. In the meantime, I will just tell you about something about the previous morning session, because both sessions are linked. That is, now you have learned about hypothesis, how we derive it, you know. Now, this will be more, you know, details about the hypothesis. Once you learn about this, you'll be able to formulate the right kind of hypothesis, you know. So various, like, you know, various types of hypothesis, sources of hypothesis, etc., etc., right? You can ask question whenever you have, you can type. And at the end, we have exercises that also will give you complete information about this. We'll just wait for a few minutes, then we'll start.
Can you talk about edge cases tomorrow session?
Tomorrow we will learn about testing of hypothesis, right? So the morning is a theory, how to test it, steps and all. But in the afternoon, I will also demonstrate you that how we apply various statistical tests to test the hypothesis. For that, we'll be sending you a data file on which I'll demonstrate here. If you have spaces already downloaded, you can open the data file and you can follow the steps what I did, so that you will also learn how we apply the test. So that would be a very wonderful experience. So, but you have to have the spaces program, whichever version you want, after 11, any version after 11, you will be able to do it on your own, and you will have a good, you know, what we call, you know, on the online, you know, experience, you know, and on experience online.
Is it always required to formulate hypothesis? Someone is asking.
Is
it always required to formulate hypothesis?
Yes, it is. That is all what we learned in the first session. To be a scientific research, we have to follow scientific method. And the second stage of scientific method is formulation of hypothesis. So it is unquestionable. Having hypothesis, where just one exception is that if you are going for exploratory research, then you don't need to hypothesis. We'll discuss it, I think, in the next week. We have sessions on research designs. Otherwise, all researches, we must have hypothesis.
Safullah has asked so many questions, sir. I think he has typed all of them, just pasted them all. Rukmini is really enjoying the session, and she's saying that it's a very good experience, sir, learning online, first of its kind. Of course, as we said, that it is first of its kind, and we really welcome you all for this, you know, first students who have actually, you are privileged and honored to have, to attend this kind of session.
Yeah.
And Khalid, what we will do is we will attend to your questions maybe during the sessions, but I appreciate that you have already written it and put it here. I'm going to copy it and paste it somewhere else in my desktop, so your chat is still saved with me, and I can send this question to Sir. It's 3:35, so I think we should go, sir. We should start. And Okay, now Nikhil is asking another question, certainly before we start. Some methods like grounded theory do not need it. Hypothesis?
Yeah, grounded theory is a subject of qualitative research where we don't have a hypothesis. We start with the research question and what is the finding? We try to develop a theory in the form of hypothesis. We call it grounded theory. We are not concerned here. Now we are dealing with quantitative research methods.
Okay, sir, we will go start with it. And let's start the first session. Your video will still be on. If you want, you can put the video back from your computer. But we are going to maximize the presentation now.
Sir. This session is in continuation with the morning session, that is formulation of hypothesis. We call it part two, the remaining part of the formulation of hypothesis. Here you will learn more about meaning of hypothesis. Then we'll discuss in detail the types of hypothesis. Morning you have asked some question. That question will be taken up here when we deal with various types of hypothesis, and also we will discuss about sources of hypothesis. On completion of this session, you will learn what is a hypothesis in a very specific way now. You will also learn about the sources of hypothesis and about the various types of hypothesis. These are our three learning objectives. Now we'll redefine the term hypothesis. We say redefine because morning you have seen very simple definition of hypothesis. Now we are redefining to make it very specific. A hypothesis is a statement that postulates the relationship between the independent and dependent variable. The new thing what you find is now we are just making it more specific. In a hypothesis, this is the basic requirement, at least one independent variable and one dependent variable. Let us take a hypothesis. Psychosocial well-being and life satisfaction of elderly are associated. Now, in this hypothesis, psychosocial well-being is independent variable and life satisfaction of elderly is dependent variable. You can recall the meaning of independent variable and dependent variable. Independent variable is which we assume to explain the dependent variable. So here we are assuming that one's psychosocial well-being will explain the life satisfaction. So we call life satisfaction as a dependent variable. Now we'll discuss about sources of hypothesis now. Theories are in fact a seedbed of hypothesis. Many hypotheses stem from a body of theories, outcome of logical deductions of theories. Theories represent what are known. A logical deductions from these theories constitutes which must be true if the theories are true. These are the two basic presumptions, basic premises on which we develop our hypothesis. Based on these presumptions, we can develop several hypotheses. It's not at all difficult. Many young researchers find it very difficult to develop hypotheses. But now, what I am going to explain to you, if you can understand this you can easily develop as many hypotheses as you want. I will take up Durkheim's theory, a classical theory. This is a very good example of how theories is a seedbed of hypothesis. While explaining his theory, he derived one after another presumptions, and that all become famous hypotheses. Let us see how he developed various hypotheses, or you can say presumptions, based on his classical theory. Durkheim found that the rate of suicide among Catholics was lesser than the rate of suicide among Protestants. This is the basic theory. Now, based on this theory, he theorized, or you can say he explained, why it is. So he said, because due to stronger forms of social control and cohesion among Catholics than among Protestants is the reason for lesser number of suicide in Catholics than Protestants. And see that how he presumes number of hypotheses. One is on the basis of the explanation, social control and social cohesion, he said. Further explained that suicide is less common among women than men. Further, he said, suicide is more common among single people than among who are romantically partnered. Married, you can say. On the similar lines, he further derived, suicide is less common among those who have children than those who are issueless. Further, he also derived, soldiers commit suicide more often than civilians. And in continuation, he said, rates of suicide are higher during peacetime than they are during wars, and so on. Now, this is one example which tells us that from one theory, how we can derive number of derivatives of theories, derivative, what we call hypothesis. In all these presumptions or derivative, you can say, one thing is the base, that is social control and cohesion. Let us consider the following research topic: factors affecting life satisfaction of elderly. This is the topic. Now we will discuss to explain the topic we have just taken up. So we look for theory of aging, which explains about satisfaction among the elderly people. While reviewing the literature, a researcher comes across various theories of aging. These theories form the basis of several hypotheses. One very popular theory is activity theory of aging. Activity theory of aging argues that the more active people are, the more likely they are to be satisfied with their life. Further, activity theory assumes that how we think of ourselves is based on the role or activities in which we engage. That is self-perception. And while reviewing the theories on aging, one come across the interplay of number of variables. You can see this visual. The various theories or in derivatives give us the indication that informal activity affects life satisfaction, formal activity affects social activity, affects life satisfaction, spiritual well-being affects life satisfaction, social support affects life satisfaction, self-perception affects life satisfaction. Now, this will form the basis for our formulation of hypothesis.
This can also be called as theoretical framework?
No, that will come little later. This is just, we collect all the variables which affect from the theory review. We get this list of variables. Now, we'll formulate hypothesis, or we can go for theoretical framework and then hypothesis. Review of literature, review of theories reveals that life satisfaction of elderly is affected by a set of variables such as self-perception, social support, and participation in social activities. Therefore, self-perception, social support, and participation in social activity are independent variables, and life satisfaction elderly is a dependent variable. Now we will construct our theoretical framework based on the activity theory and variables at play. This is what we call theoretical framework. Now, you can just have a look and just try to understand. First of all, emotional well-being and social activity, they interact together, and that affects the self-perception and which leads to the life satisfaction. This is the one channel. Then emotional well-being affects the formal activities, and formal activities affects the life satisfaction. The other trend also found in reviewed literature is social activity affects informal activity and it affects life satisfaction. This is only exemplary. Now, based on your review of literature, you can develop your own theoretical framework where you can see, you can show that how the variables is going to affect the dependent variable, and then it's very easy to formulate hypothesis.
Should we find a question?
Okay, or we'll just have some hypothesis. Yeah, now you can see that these hypotheses are based on the theoretical framework. Participation in social activities and life satisfaction are associated. Participation in formal activities leads to higher life satisfaction. Participation in informal activity leads to higher life satisfaction. Self-perception and life satisfaction are associated. Emotional well-being and life satisfaction are associated. Emotional well-being and so on and so forth. The formulation of hypothesis becomes so easy once you finalize your theoretical framework. Yeah, now if you have any question, you can just type it. I'll try to answer the question. But the very important part of hypothesis formulation we have just completed.
Khalid asked this question, sir. Among the following null hypothesis statements, which one is the best? First, there is no significant relationship between spending pattern and satisfaction level of online customers. Mm-hmm. Second, there is no significant difference between spending pattern and satisfaction level of online customers. One is relationship, the other one is difference.
Difference. Both are okay. It is the researcher who has to select which hypothesis you want to test. Technically, if you want to test the difference, you should have numeric data at a higher level of measurement, like ratio or interval. Whereas if you take the association or relation, we can have lower level of data. I think little later you will be also very clear about it. But both the axes are correct. You can go ahead with either.
So some people are typing questions, we'll wait for them.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's very important to understand up until here and then move on.
Yes, that's true. It's a very important stage of research.
We also see sometimes that in many theses, I have personally found that we don't focus on theoretical framework. And theoretical framework is always missing. And I've also seen that many people do not derive hypothesis from theory. Like you said, it's a base bed for it, but it is not shown in those kind of research.
Yeah.
What is the impact of not mentioning those things in our theory?
I think two questions. In fact, one is that you don't find theoretical framework. The answer is very simple. It's ignorance. They don't refer to the books. They don't see what are the various steps of research. If you don't have theoretical framework, you are very uncertain about what hypothesis will suit your research. You don't know whether this hypothesis is correct or not. This many questions will come to your mind. Once you give your theoretical framework,
you can find out
everything. You know that, okay, this hypothesis fits here. This hypothesis. That's why we call it theoretical framework. That is the first question. So theoretical framework is a must. Whether you give a drawing or not, that's a different thing. But you must write that on what basis you are going to formulate hypothesis. So it will also give you the direction for your research work. So it's very important. People are not doing it, means that is just, you can say, ignorance. I mean, they are not updating their knowledge. Now, those who are participating in this online workshop, I'm sure, you are convinced. Once you are convinced, then you follow. If you are not convinced, you raise questions. I'll wait till that point when you say, yes, I need theoretical framework. You can type on your screen. You can say that whether you are convinced or not that we need a theoretical framework. Your another question is that many theses, hypothesis is missing. The answer is those many theses are not a scientific research. Because scientific research uses scientific method. And you have seen that in scientific method, formulation hypothesis is second stage of research. So the simple answer is that those researches are not scientific research. This is the logic. Yeah. Is it clear?
Yes. I think we should move on, sir.
Yeah. Questions are not... Yeah. We'll move on to the next. Now, briefly, we'll also know about characteristics of good hypothesis. There are several basic characteristics, but some are very important characteristics. We will see in the next slide. Three important characteristics of good hypothesis. Because after seeing the theoretical framework, you may have the idea that there will be n number of hypotheses. Shall we take all, or what is the limit? Now I'm giving you the answer. You should select the hypothesis which is very brief and clear. That's the first characteristics. We should not take any hypothesis. Second characteristic is it should provide direction. Once you formulate a hypothesis, you have to be very judicious. You have to see that this hypothesis is going to give me direction for my study. If not, you drop that hypothesis. In that way, you'll be able to select set of hypotheses who are very much necessary for the study. And finally, that's also very important, is hypothesis must be empirically testable. As a researcher, once you decide a hypothesis, you should also know, or before you decide to take up a hypothesis, you must know that the independent variable and dependent variable in the hypothesis, how you are going to measure it. That's called empirically testable. A little more detail I'll hypothesis should be clearly stated and brief. It should be brief. It makes your research problem easier to understand and also for the researcher to test. It should be concise statement. You should not go for a long sentences with a conjunction, association, or relationship, or difference.
Sir, slides are moving very fast.
Okay. No, this I have already explained you. That's why I am just, again, no problem. You tell me. Number first is this, that it should be brief and clear. That means it should show how the independent and dependent variable are related. Whether you are testing association, relationship, difference, etc. That should be included in your hypothesis.
Sir, some questions from How many hypotheses should be formulated for the research? Tell me the number which is more feasible.
It was also asked in, I think, second or third, how many objectives. So this question is not a question at all, because I'll repeat the same example which I put given to the participant of, I think, first session. How many chapatis or roti you should eat when you are hungry? Can anybody suggest that you should have 3 chapatis, 4 chapatis, 6 chapatis? Is there any mathematics? Is there any formula to calculate? No. No dietitian also can tell you.
It's the hunger that will define.
Exactly. It is the hunger. Same applies to the hypothesis. How many hypotheses can collect the information to explain the problem? 3? Enough? 5? Enough? I have seen one of the best hypotheses by IIT Guwahati, of a professor of IIT Guwahati, some 32 pages of thesis, one hypothesis. This is acclaimed as one of the best research. It has gone to the international journals and they have acclaimed it as the best, one of the best research work in the recent times.
Could you brief about it, sir? What was that hypothesis?
No, I have no idea about that content because it's on engineering, okay. Something related to engineering subject. But news came just like this, that it is just around 30 pages, one hypothesis. So this is the minimum. So when you are formulating hypothesis, you have to examine that what are the various dimensions of your research subject, and for each dimension you should have 1-2 hypotheses, and always the criteria is that how many hypotheses can explain your research problem. That is the criteria of number of hypotheses.
So if we have to define the difference between the theoretical framework and hypothesis, how do we do that? What's the basic difference, Dr. Nikhil asks?
Yeah. Theoretical framework shows the interrelationship between the variables. Now, when we put into the statement form, we call it hypothesis. Just like in our theoretical framework, you have seen social activity, informal activities, and life satisfaction. This is the theoretical framework. That you have got this indication through review of literature, if they are interdependent. Now, we put it into the statement form. We say that higher the participation in social activity leads to higher life satisfaction. So this is the difference. Theoretical framework is the list of the variables in a pictorial form, diagrammatically, and from that we derive the hypothesis.
Sir, Siraj is asking that how many hypotheses should be formulated for the research? Tell me the number which is more feasible. Please suggest me.
Just I have explained to you, it is not possible. Nobody can suggest. It all depends that how, what are the various perspective of your problem, and from each perspective or dimensions of the problem, at least one hypothesis we recommend. We say that you should have one, at least, for one perspective of your problem.
So in your experience, sir, if I ask, how many hypotheses should be there in a PhD thesis, keeping the time and the limitations in mind?
That's true.
What would be the average hypothesis which can be done within the
PhD? I think this is the right question. Instead of asking how many hypotheses, you have to see the practicability, you know, that is collecting data, analysis, and all those things. So here, because every hypothesis needs set of data and its processing and then analysis and all. So in my experience, I have found a good research work with four, five, six hypotheses is the my experience in general. Generally, average is think five or six is the a good research work.
In cost effectiveness of traditional medicine, what kind of hypothesis can be framed?
Now you have to identify what are the variables which affect the cost effectiveness of the medicine. Then those variables you can put into the statement form, that is hypothesis. You have to just find out what are the independent variable which affects cost effectiveness, and then you can hypothesize it. The hypothesis, that is another, you know, the testing, you can say that whether we should take a hypothesis or not, you have to just try to understand that whether testing this hypothesis will give me direction to proceed for my study. I'll be able to achieve my objective. So you have to test each and every, scrutinize each and every hypothesis. We'll go ahead. The third characteristic, what we just I just mentioned, is that a hypothesis must be empirically testable. Empirically means we must know the instrument which we are going to use to collect data for independent and dependent variable. That's called empirically testable. Then only we should formulate that hypothesis. Unless and until you know how you are going to get the data, there is no meaning in taking up a hypothesis, because we cannot test it. Or to understand this more clearly, you should keep in mind that it should not be a moral judgment. It should not be something from intuition, you know, which is very difficult, or I should say impracticable, to test it empirically.
Can you explain a little bit,
sir,
this one? Intuitive or?
Yeah. Something, you know, which we cannot collect data. Moral judgments, you know, like truth prevails, or, you know, you can say that those who are having a high moral value, they'll be more efficient. Now, measuring the moral or morality or integrity, for example, is very difficult. I mean, we don't have instrument, and developing instrument to measure integrity is a really difficult job. And even if you develop the instrument, it's very doubtful that whether the person will accept. There are efforts have been made, you know, to develop the instrument to measure the corruption among, you know, the police personnel, but they failed totally. Because even after developing the instrument, they were not able to get the data. So the answers were manipulated. So this we call, you know, the moral judgment. You know, we should not use this thing in our hypothesis, where we cannot get the data. After death, everybody goes to heaven. You cannot prove it. You cannot get the data whether a person goes to the heaven after death. So we cannot take this kind of hypothesis. This is very philosophical, of course, but this is an example by which you can test your hypothesis and be sure that you'll be able to get data for your independent and dependent variable. Yeah. It also reminds me that when you say how many hypotheses, one more thing, one more tip I give you, that is, one is the dimensions, the perspective of your problem. The second part is the research question, which we developed in the first session, we discussed about it. Every research question should have at least one answer, and that answer is nothing but hypothesis. We call it, hypothesis is a tentative answer of research questions. So if you have three research questions, minimum three hypotheses you will have. You can have five, you can have six. So the research question could be one indicator of your number of hypotheses. Yes, for this part of the discussion, if you have any doubt or any clarity you want, any question you have, you can just type and send me, I'll answer. Then we'll move to second part of our this session. Yeah, okay.
What is the relation between objective and hypothesis?
In research, once you formulate your research problem, your next job is to identify objectives. Objectives are the variables you want to study. For example, life satisfaction of elderly is your topic, and the objectives would be that the variables in the research review literature you have found, social support, psychological health. So the objective will be to study about social support. This is your objective. See that. Just try to understand. To understand spiritual well-being among elderly, to know about psychosocial health of elderly. These are objectives. Now, hypotheses are, you take social support and life satisfaction and put into the statement form. Now you say social support and life satisfaction of elderly are associated. So you can say the steps are like this: formulation of research problem, research questions, objectives, and hypothesis. I hope it's clear.
Is it important to link every hypothesis to objective? It's a question from Sarah.
It's not very necessary, but it's linked with the objectives. Variables, what you will be taking for hypothesis, will be some in the office. You collect data for that very then.
Another question, sir, social well-being and financial literacy are associated. In that way, shall I have to take each variable and develop hypothesis?
No, two variables you have to take up. Social well-being
and financial literacy.
Financial literacy, you can just correlate and find out, test it.
So for each variable, can a hypothesis be developed?
Not for each, for two. A set of two variables, we develop hypothesis.
It is a follow-up question. Okay, fine. Okay, sir.
Yeah.
So you can move.
Move to the last part of this afternoon session.
Types of hypothesis.
Yeah. Now, we'll discuss about various types of hypotheses. And the hypotheses are like sorry for interruption. We'll discuss about first the classification of hypotheses from the statistician point of view. For the purpose of testing statistical significance, hypotheses are classified as null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. This is the classification by statisticians. This is also conventional, or you can say formal approach to test the hypothesis. Null hypothesis. It involves a statement that says there is no association, relationship, difference between two variables. For example, there is no association between participation in social activities and life satisfaction. We call it null hypothesis. The hypothesis also may state that there is no significant difference when different groups are compared with respect to a particular variable. For example, there is no difference in the life satisfaction of elderly who participate in social activity and those who do not participate in such activity. Alternative hypothesis: if the test of a statistical significance rejects the null hypothesis, we accept the hypothesis that is called alternative hypothesis. Suppose the hypothesis, there is no association between participation in social activities and life satisfaction, is rejected, then we accept the hypothesis that is, participation in social activities and life satisfaction are associated. This hypothesis is known as alternative hypothesis. Other forms of hypothesis. We call simple hypothesis. Simple hypothesis predicts the relationship between a single independent variable and a single dependent variable. This is called simple hypothesis. Example is participation in social activities and life satisfaction are associated. IV stands for independent variable, DV stands for dependent variable. You can see here one independent variable and one dependent variable. This hypothesis we call simple hypothesis. Complex hypothesis. Complex hypothesis predicts the relationship between two or more independent variable and two or more dependent variables. Example of complex multiple independent variable. That is complex hypothesis where we have more than one independent variable. Example is participation in social activities and self-perception are associated with life satisfaction. Here you can see there are two independent variables. Participation in social activities and self-perception, these are two independent variables, and one dependent variable, that is life satisfaction. We call complex hypothesis or complex multiple independent variable hypothesis. We have also example of complex multiple dependent variable hypothesis. This is also complex hypothesis, in fact, but here dependent variable are more than one. We say example is participation in social activities is associated with self-perception and life satisfaction. You can see here there is one independent variable and two dependent variables. We call complex multiple dependent variable hypothesis. Now we also divide, classify hypothesis as directional hypothesis and non-directional hypothesis. Directional hypothesis, they specify the expected directions of the relationship between variables. That is, the researcher predicts not only the existence of relationship, but also its nature. Means it also tells whether it is positive, negative, higher, lower. This type of hypothesis suggests the outcome the investigator expects at the end of the study. The investigator, researcher, bases this hypothesis on the trends apparent from previous research on this topic. See the example. Older persons who participate in informal social activities have lower life satisfaction than those who participate in formal social activities. Here you can see the word lower. It could be higher, it could be positive, negative. To use these words, we call direction or the nature of the relation, it becomes directional hypothesis. Remember, it is based on the trends you have observed while reviewing the literature. Such hypothesis provides a definite direction to the prediction. Non-directional hypothesis is used when findings of previous studies are contradictory. That means one finding contradicts the other finding. Both are opposite. One says there is association, other says there is no association. One says positive, other says negative. You should not stipulate direction of the relationship. It should be based on the data available. For example, participation in social activities and life satisfaction are associated. And finally, we go to causal hypothesis. Proposes a cause and effect relationship between two or more variables. The independent variable is manipulated to cause effect on the dependent variable. The dependent variable is measured to examine the effect created by the independent variable. the subjects in the experimental group who are exposed to the independent variable demonstrate greater change as measured by the dependent variable than do the subjects in the control group who are not exposed to the independent variable. Example will make it very clear. The causal hypothesis, null hypothesis, is practice of yoga will not have effect on the satisfaction of older person. An alternative causal hypothesis would be practice of yoga will have effect on life satisfaction of older person. The word effect is very important in case of causal hypothesis. You can see the experimental research. E stands for experimental group. Y1 is the measurement mode. X is the stimulus, the yoga in this case. Y2 is the measurement of experimental group after yoga practice. C is a control group where no yoga practice is given. There also we measure the same time when we measure the experimental group. So you can see Y1 dash and Y2 dash. And by this we can prove whether yoga has effect on the life satisfaction of elderly. This is called testing of causal hypothesis.
Sir, question is, are directional hypothesis good or formulate? Good to formulate, sorry.
Definitely, it's a good, but you must not forget that you have to make the extensive study to assess the trend that you have enough evidence of researches which have shown that kind of direction. Then only we take up directional hypothesis. If you are not having sufficient evidences, if you take the directional hypothesis, there's a likelihood that it will be rejected. More chances of being rejected. So trend should be reviewed very carefully. Then only we go for directional hypothesis. I hope it's clear.
Yes, it's clear.
Yeah. Shall we sum up? In a very precise term, a hypothesis is statement that postulates the relationship between independent and dependent variable. Theories are the, in fact, seedbed of hypothesis. Many hypotheses stem from a body of theories, outer deductions of theories. Life satisfaction elderly is affected by a set of variables such as self-perception, social support, and participation. A number of factors can be formulated by selecting any of the above two variables. For the purpose of testing, statistical significance hypotheses are classified as null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. Then we have simple hypothesis, complex hypothesis, directional and non-directional hypothesis, and finally you have learned about causal hypothesis. Now we have frequently asked questions. Why theories are called seedbed of hypothesis? From where we can get to know about theories? What are the characteristics of a good hypothesis? What is the purpose of classifying hypothesis? if you want to answer these questions or you want to see the model answers, okay, it's already displayed. Many hypotheses stem from a body of theories, outcome of logical deduction of theories. That is why theories are called as seed bed of hypothesis. While reviewing the literature, a researcher comes across various theories. Hypothesis should be brief and clear. It should provide direction, and it must be empirically testable. These are the characteristics of good hypothesis. The purpose of classification hypothesis is to select an appropriate statistical test and test of significance.
Quiz is being sent to you, and you can go ahead and answer them. Questions will be displayed on your screen. You will take the video off for a while. Please answer on the screen. You have got the option to choose. Do not answer in chat. Just answer on the screen. The answer, sir,
Is increasing.
Yes.
Yeah.
We request all the participants to try it. Nobody can see your answer. Just try it.
Yes.
Sir, please give few examples of research problem and hypothesis generated out of it and how.
Yeah. Say one subject I can show you. The effect of self-help group on empowerment of women. The hypothesis we can frame like functioning of self-help groups leads to higher empowerment, a directional hypothesis. Participation in self-help groups leads to empowerment, a simple hypothesis or alternative hypothesis. You can have a complex hypothesis like socio-economic status and participation in self-help groups leads to higher empowerment level. Is it okay?
Someone will ask you, sir, is the Riemann hypothesis still a million question? Pardon? Is the Riemann hypothesis, maybe some hypothesis, name of a hypothesis?
Riemann.
Riemann, R-I-E-M-A-N-N. Hypothesis is still a million year question. Well, you might have to elaborate, Mr. Imran Khan.
What is Riemann hypothesis?
Okay, sir.
Okay, no, I'll just something I'll highlight, you know, this may be a question based on the very, initial literature on social research. Today, it's not a million dollar question. Hypothesis is very clear today, well explained, well tested. Many of the hypotheses have taken up shape of theories. So now, I think maybe 50 years, 60 years back, this may be a question, a millionary question, million question, but today it's not. It's very useful, and most of the theories being developed, they are after testing the hypothesis today.
So why do we always frame hypothesis as no significant relationship or no relationship or no association? Why is it always in no?
You mean why we take up null hypothesis?
I guess that's the question from Fatima.
Fatima, yeah. See, it is by the statisticians, in fact, they have forced the researchers, research community, that we should start with null hypothesis. Because they say, the moment you frame a hypothesis, you are subjective. You are taking a part. You are not objective, which is the characteristics of scientific method. You are saying that there is an association. The moment you say there is association, means your tendency would be to prove that there is association. So the bias come in the research. That is the arguments of the statisticians. So they say that, why can't we start with taking up no association, where you will be unbiased and you test, and if the results are null hypothesis, you accept your hypothesis. So traditionally or conventionally, we are following this, and I think there is some logic. But again, the research educators say that it is not a very serious explanation. But as a researcher, you have to be objective. You have to learn how to become objective. Then only you can do a very good research. It's not only through hypothesis you become biased. You can be biased in data collection. So even if you form a hypothesis, if you are biased in your data collection, if you are biased in sampling, I mean, you are spoiling the scientific nature of the research. So in social science researches, we are not very strict about starting with the null hypothesis. You can start with alternative hypothesis. But for testing, when you are testing the hypothesis, you should propose a null hypothesis. The reason is that most critical values, you know, what you call the table values, are given based on the null hypothesis. So that's the reason we take the null hypothesis for testing purpose. I hope, Fatima, it's clear. Type. Yes.
Another question, sir. How will we be able to know that this or that hypothesis is empirically testable?
It's very simple. I already mentioned it. Again, I'll repeat it. In the hypothesis, you have independent variable and dependent variable. Now, you see that where you have instrument to measure the independent and dependent variable. If you have instrument, that is a standardized scale or questionnaire available, or you can prepare it as you think, then you can say that it is empirically testable. Means you are sure that you will be able to get the data for testing it. That's called empirically testable. It's more or less examining the independent variable measurability. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. Can Fine. We go through the question, sir, and then you can explain it?
Yeah. First question. A hypothesis which predicts the relationship between two or more independent variable and two or more dependent variable is a complex hypothesis. 61% of participants have said yes. Correct. Second one is hypothesis which predicts not only the existence of relationship but also its nature is called directional hypothesis.
Okay, I think there's some confusion in
it's a directional hypothesis. When you get the nature of the relationship, it's a directional hypothesis. The third question is, hypothesis which proposes a test cause and effect relationship between two or more variable is a causal hypothesis. 22% have said yes. When finding of previous studies are contradictory, we prefer to formulate non-directional hypothesis. 22% people have said this. Any other questions?
Now this is open for question and answer session. While sir will explain about tomorrow's session a little bit here.
Friends, tomorrow we will discuss what testing of hypothesis and afternoon is devoted to testing of hypothesis. It needs a lot of your attention. It's a little bit technical. I'll also demonstrate you how we test hypothesis using SPSS. So I think if you software, you can also have some kind of hands-on experience while I demonstrate. Any version of SPSS after 11 you can use, and I think we'll be sending you data file, sample data file, on which I will demonstrate you the testing of hypothesis. You can use those data file and also see the result by your own practice. That's all for today.
Another question is coming up, sir. My question is related to data. Is it necessary to collect primary data if secondary data fulfills the need of the research?
Yeah, I think general practice is that research thesis should be based on primary data and maybe supported by the secondary data. Vice versa is not considered as a good research. And the basic reason is that secondary data has been compiled or collected by someone else for a very different purpose. Using those data for your own research, you cannot be, you know, very original kind of research, you know. So the practice is there, I know, particularly in commerce and all, they take data from bank or some companies and they do this. But it's not a good practice. And if you are using secondary data, many of the research essential steps,
but what should
you will
people
not
do,
be.
Sir? What should people do if financial data is not available firsthand?
No, that all depends on your formulation of research problem. You have to formulate problem in such a way that you will be contributing your original data available. Is not a original research, it's already done by somebody and you are using as a second person.
I think the question is, even if they wanted to collect primary data, for example in commerce and finance, if they wanted to ask some financial question, it could be confidential for banks or any person, they are anyway not going to get the correct answer or manipulated answer. So again, the research is getting in a bad shape.
Yeah, that is a problem, I understand. But as a researcher, you cannot be exempted from the basic research requirements. That is your problem. That is the problem of a particular subject. So you have to focus on the area of problem, the studies, where you can get the data. If you are you know beforehand that this data I may not get, that problem we cannot go ahead for our research work. And remember, when we are using a scientific method, we are going to draw inferences based on the data. Now, the secondary data, another problem is, we are not sure about its authenticity. How authentic is the data is a big question. Because based on that, what inference you are drawing are also questionable. These are some of the reasons by which we say that one should go for primary data.
All right, sir, I think we are done with today's questions and answers. And we look forward to having you tomorrow. As sir has mentioned that for a better demonstration in the afternoon session of tomorrow, you need to have SPSS handy with you so that we can do some exercises together. And in the morning session, we still have some theory part, but I'll be providing you the data files. It will go to the folder that you have been shared with, or it will be sent to an email as well. So with this, if nobody has got any question, we would like to go ahead and close it. Thank you very much, all of you, for participation. And if you have any question, you still can send us email and leave here in the chat box. But sir will leave now, and we will leave the event now. Thank you very much, everybody. Hope you enjoyed the session.
Yeah. Thank you.
Have a great evening. Bye-bye.
Yeah, bye.